But you've been making up credits and working so hard to study in England, I say. Mia shrugged. Look at that, she says, pointing at Kant. He's running in our direction with a dead hare clamped between his teeth. Oh no, God! Poor thing! Is that a rabbit? Sigrid comes into the living room after the others have gone to bed. I'm sitting in the chair in front of the television, watching news I've already seen. She stands and watches for a few minutes, a piece about a mother being reunited with her daughter in a flood-stricken region of East Africa, the rest of their family likely dead following a landslide. I brace myself several times, take a deep breath to say something, but still can't find the words to tell her that I know I've let her down. Can't formulate any sentence that is sufficiently nuanced to make space for her while making sense to me. How are you feeling? Sigrid asks. She's perched herself on the edge of the chair in the corner of the room, one leg twitching. She looks nervous. Fine, I reply, turning off the television. My back hurts a bit, but it's better today than it was yesterday. So, what's the plan from here on out? She asks. I smile. The plan? Yes. When's your next round of chemo? I can't recall. A few weeks, I think, I reply. I've decided to stop the chemotherapy, but I can't tell Sigrid that, not now. I'll come back and see you then, she says. You don't need to do that, I reply. Sigrid rests her head in her hands, leans forward. I'm surprised. Spend too long simply trying to rise to my feet. My stomach aches. I make my way over to her, sit on the arm of her chair, and place my hand on her back. Slowly stroke it. She's grown thinner. I can feel her ribs. They judder as she sobs beneath my touch.